And says the hangout is live on air. Hello, everybody. Welcome to yet another episode of PSEC, Paradigm Shift in Educational Comedy. I'm here with Rich Tate, or General Tate, or whatever the heck you want to refer to him as. And mostly what a lot of people will notice with a lot of the discussions on the Google Hangout, it tends to be very oriented towards female empowerment because, well, basically females bash the crap out of themselves like way too much. And plus, because, like me personally, most guys tend to have like this huge, like, you know, societal ego thing going. So guys tend to kind of see each other as threats. That's why, like, when you, you know, if you're talking like on an online forum or something, and, you know, I'm talking about whether it's a programming project or whatever topic, it doesn't matter. Most of the people that you see butting in, wagging their proverbial dicks around, usually have literal dicks as well. Not saying that girls are perfect, not, you know, being all like feminazi over here or anything, but just saying that girls usually aren't out to try to, like, compete with me. So that's why I tend to have more of a peace with them than most guys. Of course, the males I deal with are fewer than the females, but of course, there are guys that I know that don't have their head shoved firmly up their asses, such as Rich here. And needless to say, Rich had a good idea. Just to make it fair, so that, you know, the ladies know we're trying to help them and not pick on them and not single them out, we're going to go into male insecurities today and, you know, basically calling males on their own bullshit in general. Some things pertaining to women, other things not having nothing to do with women. But I figure if, you know, us being guys here are going to be making videos with girls and calling, you know, the female dichotomy on its shit, we have to be fair and we have to call the male dichotomy on its shit too. Because, you know, not trying to, don't want to give the impression that we're all superior up here, like, oh yeah, we're guys, yeah, we're cool, we got no problems whatsoever, we totally got our heads straight, you know. No, fuck all that. So, Rich had a good idea with that, so I'm going to let him, you know, begin the rant with that. But at the end of all of this, we have a special little surprise in regards to something very funny that illustrates this beautifully that has happened within the last few weeks on the NASA headquarters DeviantArt group. And it's totally freaking hilarious. And I'm sure that, you know, all parties involved will be watching this eventually. So, hello there. This is going to be really fun. So, but that's for last. That's going to be a little surprise. So, we're going to leave that to the end, but for now, Rich, take it away.
Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, good brunch, wherever the heck you are in the world. This is Richard Hamilton of the NASA Headquarters Group, founder, and I'm just going to start off on male insecurities. Today has been kind of one of those days, you know, for me personally, and I just figured it'd be important to bring it up, discuss it, talk about it with the world. You know, we all, us guys, we've all had our own fair share of crap come across in our lives. You know, we all get insecure over what society says and what society, you know, labels for us, and I just figured I'd bring some of it into the light, you know. But anyway, I just kind of want to start off with the insecurity between males and females and the way I kind of feel about it. Primarily, it comes right down to it, you know, we see pretty girls, you know, walking around, and I'm sure we've all seen that, you know, seen some pretty girl walking through a restaurant, through on the street somewhere, out in public, and we go, man, she's pretty, you know. And we ask a bunch of questions, you know, well, she's single, you know, does she see me, does she notice me, you know, is she paying attention, you know, and then we start doubting our abilities to be able to, you know, ask or walk up to them and say, you know, hey, you're very pretty, you know, you want to hang out sometime, even if you don't know them, or if you know them personally, we all do it. We doubt ourselves and we walk up to them and, you know, our minds start running a million miles an hour and we think of everything but the right thing to say. We think of, you know, something really stupid and we bash ourselves and go, ah, she's too pretty, she's way too out of my league, or, you know, oh, she's really smart and I'm dumb in comparison. Or, you know, we just think of all these stupid little things, you know, that, or, you know, she's hanging out with a bunch of other dudes that you don't know, and, you know, they're working out at the gym, and, you know, if you're not in the best of shape, you know, you may work with that, you know, gee, if you want to hang out with me, I'm not as in good of shape as those other dudes, even though probably, and I'm not making any general specifics, because not everybody is, you know, a complete...
Hey, Rich, your sound crapped out there for, like, about 15 seconds, just to let you know. You seem all good now, but your sound went completely dead for about 15 seconds. I don't know if that was just on my end or if it blanked out for everybody else, too, so you might want to, like, repeat. The last thing I heard is you were saying, or she, you know, with a bunch of other dudes, and that sort of thing, and then it, like, blank.
Yeah, my camera does that. Okay, anyway, backtracking. You know, she's hanging out with a bunch of other guys, you know, in public or in a bar or wherever. And, you know, they're good-looking guys like you. You know, they're potentially smart. You know, they got, generally, they're the kind of people that have got, you know, muscle mass like Hulk Hogan on their arms. And you kind of look at your arms if you don't work out and you kind of look at them and you go, gee, well, she's hanging out with all those guys, you know. So probably one of them's her boyfriend, and you make all these ridiculous, you overthink, and you make all these ridiculous predictions of how it's going to go, and then you shut yourself down, and you just kind of, you know, you walk away discouraged, and it's just, it's sad, really, you know. And there's millions of people on this planet right now, millions of men out there that are going through this perpetual loop of sorrow and misery. And it's sad, you know, it's discouraging. I go through it quite a bit.
And what you're not realizing is that she's actually hanging out with her three best gay friends, but they don't fit the societal, like, airy fairy sort of ooh, obviously flamboyantly gay, so they look all like muscular macho. And you don't realize that she's hanging out with her three gay friends while she's standing there thinking, why don't any guys ever tell me I'm pretty? I must be ugly. No one ever says anything. And, you know, for all you know, that could be the situation, because sometimes that is the situation.
Mm-hmm. Often very much. But that's just one instance in which I'm describing. And, I mean, it happens, you know, in public. I mean, if you look at... like in recent news stories, this was probably like 6 months old. I mean, it's not super recent, but it is recent, relatively speaking. Elliot Roger, if you recall that name, he was blared all over the news for doing the shooting down there in, what was it, Santa Clara, Santa Barbara, because he was a loner, because he, you know, thought nobody was ever going to be in love with him, nobody ever liked him. Now, do I think he was despicable for doing what he did? Absolutely. Was it not right? Yeah, it was terrible. Shot a lot of innocent people, but, you know, a lot of that crap that he was going through could have been easily prevented. That's the sad thing, and a lot of people don't realize that a lot of that could have been prevented with just some simple, you know, food for thought, if you will, things to think about, you know. And it's just one public instance, you know. We guys, it's as much of, it's almost kind of an undermining thing, you know. We think of women as being these fragile creatures, and, you know, they're you know, we place them in a societal box, and guys are supposed to be these strong, you know, masculine G.I. Joes with no feelings, and we're supposed to just kind of tough through it, and, you know, if we get sad, well, we're just supposed to beat it with our fists until it can't stand anymore. Well, that isn't true. It never was. That's, you know, one of those societal paradigms that's been put in place that is just a complete full crock of shit that just doesn't even apply to any semblance of reality. Men are just as, you know, fragile and, you know, emotionally unstable at times as women are in terms of psyche, you know. And generally in the modern generation, what we refer to with, you know, social networking and everything else, that's kind of where men and women seem to interact anymore, especially for my generation. And it's kind of just almost more of a deceptive minefield. You know, you see this, you know, you see pictures of cute girls, you know, all the time. If you're friends with plenty of them on Facebook, you know what I mean. And you see them hanging out with their boyfriends. You see them hanging out with, you know, husband, wife. And, you know, sure, you're busy in your own life, but you look at that and you kind of, you question yourself, you doubt yourself, and you go, well, why are they so happy? Why are they, you know, why are they this? Why are they that? Why do they get to have that? Why don't I have that? Blah, 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 blah. And it's just this perpetual loop of suffering that just doesn't seem to end, you know. And I guess you could say I'm more vintage. I'm just more kind of talking right now because I've been kind of going through that a little bit today. Not bad, you know, but it happens. You know, we're all human. It's part of the human experience to go through those things. It's just kind of one of those trials and tribulations you work through, especially at the turbulent age of 19. It's just one of those things. It is what it is. You can't change it. You can't make it better. You can't make it worse. And, you know, I just want to clear the steam on that, you know. And if anybody else is going through the same exact bullshit out there, you know, it's okay, you know. It's not just me or you or anybody else, you know. It's a very common problem, and it's something that needs to be brought more into the light. You know, as a society, we, going back to the original point here, but as a society, we focus more on a left-right paradigm of only it can only happen to this sex, or it can only happen to that sex, and we fail to realize that we are all, in fact, human. Just because we have different hardware doesn't necessarily mean that we're not susceptible to the same societal paradigms, but it affects us differently.
Good point. There's a big one that I used to go through a lot that I'm sure you sometimes go through, and that we always, especially guys, always like to think of it as like, oh, well, only females do this. Guys never. But guys and girls equally do the exact same thing. It's almost like psychologically projecting into a mirror. It's really crazy. And it goes like this. Basically, a girl has all these various insecurities and stuff about herself, and the guy's oblivious to the details of it. Now, the reason the girls aren't more forthcoming about these insecurities is because every time they attempt to be truthful about it and attempt to explain it and get guys to understand it, the guy's like, oh, you're being silly. You're making stuff up. That's nonsense. You're just making up excuses to avoid telling me how you actually feel. And at the same time, the girl is seeing that the guy isn't exactly being forthcoming with his feelings either. Because we're taught to be all macho, like, you know, if we're not this badass, like, yeah, you know, that girls are going to look at us like we're big freaking losers, you know, like, you know, if we're not all macho and acting tough and hard and whatever. And, you know, there's a lot of guys that think that when a girl says, hey, knock it off, you're being a creeper, that it's actually some sort of a test or something. So he's thinking, oh, that's just a test, and I gotta, like, be even more macho and chauvinistic and badass and show her who's boss, because if I can't show her, then I fail the test, and she's gonna be laughing at me and pointing at me going, God, what a loser, he couldn't even pass that test, ha ha ha, what a disgrace. And then all of his guy buddies are going to be pointing and laughing at him like, oh, you fell for that, you're a freaking loser, blah blah blah. So the guy's approaching it with all this mental malware in his head about it, so to speak. So he doesn't realize that the girl is taking all the positive qualities about herself and shooting them down and seeing them as bad or creepy or wrong or whatever, because she's always getting rejected when she tries to be herself, right? The guy has no idea that she's going through this. So, of course, she's going to see a guy trying to be polite as either he's being patronizingly sarcastic, he's making fun of her, or he's trying to get into her pants, or he has some sort of agenda or objective up his sleeve, like, uh-oh, why is he being nice to me? What does he want from me? And last but not least, if she comes to realize that he actually is being genuine, it's like she's thinking, oh, well, I see myself as creepy and wrong, so I judge that as bad about me. So if he likes these things about me, then he must be a creep and a loser too, because like attracts like. So if he likes all these creepy things about me, then he must be an even bigger creep and desperate and needy or something. So the guy doesn't realize that she's going through all of this. So it kind of puts him in a position of feeling damned if you do, damned if you don't. No matter how nice he is to her, no matter how he tries to relate and understand, he's usually getting hostily shot down, you know, being accused of all this stuff as she's psychologically projecting, and he doesn't realize that she's psychologically projecting. So at first he's kind of thinking, okay, well, maybe she's just a stuck-up bitch or something, or a game player, maybe she's having fun with my head. But, you know, 25 girls later, and they're all acting the same way, basically. The guy starts to think, well, wow, maybe there's something wrong with me. Maybe I'm just a big loser or something, and I just have to come to terms with the fact that, you know, I'm just a big loser, and, you know, so on and so forth. So we start putting ourselves down, and we're thinking, well, we may as well accept that about ourselves to prevent further pain and prevent further heartbreak and prevent, you know, having our expectations shot down and whatever. So we get into this mode where it's like, all right, well, if I'm just a big loser, I got to deal with that. And, you know, that's the ceiling of, you know, my life here. I can't pass that. I just have to come to terms with it and never try for anything better. So we start thinking that, you know, the reactions we're getting are just all completely our fault. So we're actually making her problems about us when they have absolutely nothing to do with us. And what we don't know is that if we just respect her right to be her and our right to be ourselves, and no matter how harsh she comes at us, to realize what it is and to just be compassionate, then she will experience something she's probably not used to experiencing. Genuine caring, genuine compassion, genuine kindness, and all those things she used to think couldn't actually exist. Then she has to start, you know, reevaluating herself. And through that process, one of two things is going to happen. Number one, either you're going to have a bit of back and forth, a bit of rocky road, but then you'll kind of start working as a team and clearing that up, and the friendship will get stronger and stronger, and you'll get closer and closer. And if it really gets really strong and really close, it might naturally evolve into something more than friends. It'll be something really cool. Or she just won't be able to handle the reality that's contradicting her belief systems, and she'll just keep clinging on to her belief systems, and that rubber band between the two aspects of contrast is just going to get so tight that it'll eventually snap, and she just won't have anything to do with you anymore. And as long as you're willing to respect that it's a coin toss and to not demonize her or yourself if the latter happens instead of the former, then you'll start to evolve yourself. And when she sees that you didn't demonize her when she did that, that she kicked you to the curb, and you're not all like, oh, you fucking bitch, you're just a stupid bitch for doing that to me, blah, blah, blah. When she sees that you're just like, all right, well, you know, I don't like what's going on, of course, but I respect your right to make your own choices for yourself, and if you don't want me in your life, then okay. You know, I care enough about you to let you go if that's really what you want to do. I'm not agreeing with the situation. I'm not approving of it. I don't like it. But I respect you enough that if that's what you want to do, not going to fight it. And then after that, either she'll make a turnaround thinking about herself and then draw back to you, and it'll be a conversation about how you're both feeling, or she'll still kick you to the fucking curb because she's still too latched on her belief systems. But the real trick is respecting yourself and her enough to, you know, to go through that and allow that natural flow of things. And you'll find that as you do this, your experiences with chicks is going to start to change. When drama and stupid stuff happens and there's that snapping and that drift, it won't be so hard of a hit. Your mind will be clear, you'll see what's actually going on, and it'll actually be a lot easier to respect her right to be her. And not, like, point your finger at her like, that stupid fucking bitch, you know. You actually legitimately will not feel that surface like you used to. You'll have that understanding and clear-mindedness. Because the other half of the time, you'll have the really good experiences that'll blow your mind and defy your paradigm. And when your paradigm is defined, guess what, or is defied, guess what? You'll be in the exact same spot that she's in. Because like Rich said, it's a human thing, not a gender thing. So either you'll start reevaluating yourself and start straightening your head out, which will allow you to let her in more instead of putting up walls of insecurity so that she can't come through. Or, you know, it's the same thing. Either you'll let your brain will end up imploding and you'll psychologically project and kick her to the curb, or you'll allow things to expand and get closer and amazing shit will happen. So you'll be in the exact same position that she's in. Because like Rich said, this isn't totally not a gender thing. This is a human thing. Because we're all taught that we have the right to be individuals and defend each other's individuality, you know, defend our individuality. Well, at the same time, we're taught conform. This is that, you have to do this that way, so on and so forth. So you're trying to be an individual while trying to conform. And what this does is it makes it so that everybody else is taking your individuality as an attack on theirs, and you're taking everybody else's individuality as an attack on you. So it's a big clusterfuck of shit, and both genders are involved. Guys and girls may express concepts differently, just like every unique individual does that, but emotions are human. Guys and gals all basically want the same thing. They want good friends who actually legitimately are genuine and like you for who you are, and vice versa. They hope that eventually maybe one of those friends will become more than a friend and have that special thing there. They want to be accepted. They want to be loved. They want to be able to tell someone about their shitty, horrible day without the person they're telling, you know, taking three steps back and wondering whether or not there's some medication they should be taking, or, you know, so on and so forth. Just, you know, your right to be human, to be happy, to be sad, to be all these other human emotions. And our society has gotten to the point to where human emotions are actually deemed as neurological disorders. It's like, if you're sad for longer than society claims that you should be, or different types of sadness and what have you, then, oh, there must be a disorder wrong with you. There's something wrong. Or even if you're too happy. Uh-oh. They're too happy. Are they high on something? Or do they have an imbalance? Maybe they're ADHD. They're a little too happy, a little too hyper. That's creepy. Really? It is? Being human is creepy? What are we, the fucking Borg? Oh, yeah, we are. See, the Borg on Star Trek, they're a metaphor for our current society. Few people connect that together. And with that, I will step back off the soapbox.
Absolutely, and, you know, we see it every day on social networking and social media, and it's sad, really. I mean, you know, people are so unaware and, you know, so locked in their own boxes, if you will, boxes of insecurity and stupidity and other various random bullcrap that they can come up with to try to deny the true reality that things could be different if they just, you know, let go for a second and open their mind to potential possibilities of what could happen and what could occur. I've seen it happen millions of times, more than I can count. It's just, you know, it is what it is, and there's nothing you can really do about it. I mean, it's just, you know, it's part of the human experience, and it's just something we all have to go through at this point, and I don't know if it'll ever end. I don't know if it'll be, you know, something that the human race will work through, you know, like everything else in society, you know, if we'll figure out the truth and, you know, turn all of that drama and suffering into something more constructive, you know, and positive. But, insecurity, I mean, it's just kind of, it's really a universal thing. It's not just something that you can pin on one sex or another. I mean, the media is one of the biggest criminals behind that lie, you know, that women are the insecure ones and men are supposed to be these, you know, knights in shining armor. They're supposed to come rescue these damsels in distress and save them from, you know, the perpetual dragon that's inside of them. Well, I'm sorry, but, you know, that's a two-way street, you know. Men have got their own demons and dragons inside of them, too, that, you know, pull on their the mental psyche, you know, just as much, you know. And that's the one thing I can say about reality. It's as much mental as it is physical. It's not just, you know, a physical world in which we live in. It's more so a mental one. And some days are easier than others, but, you know, for me personally, today's been kind of one of those, you know, one of those days of just kind of like, you know, I see other happy people, you know, that are together, and I'm just kind of wondering myself, why not me? But of course, I know the answer, and I know in time it'll happen to me too, and, you know, I don't get all depressed and all down, like, oh, it's not going to happen, you know. Now, a year ago, I did it all the time. I said it would never happen. No way. No chance in hell. And what does the quantum mirror throw at me? It throws at me a beautiful woman. I'm not going to say her name. I'm going to keep her private. But if she ever does eventually watch this, she knows that I'm talking about her. We're not together anymore, but for 10 months we were. And at first, it was just complete and utter disbelief. I couldn't believe it. You know, here's this pretty brunette girl, you know, from Texas of all places. And, you know, here she is in front of me. Never thought it would happen. I said it wouldn't happen. I didn't realize it was the quantum mirror calling me on my crock of shit at that point. But I do now. And, the relationship builds into something pretty nice and pretty good, and we kind of come out of the closet with each other, and we exchange our thoughts and our feelings, and we gain each other's trust, and we let our guards down, and then ensuing drama kicks in, you know. Her personal life, or her home life goes to shit, you know, and I watched her deteriorate, you know. And as a result, it's kind of a cascade flow. It's like a domino effect. You tip one domino over, all the dominoes start to fall. And it just perpetually got worse and worse and worse and worse. And then those conflicting ideas, you know, as Dave so vibrantly put it, it's like a rubber band, you know, tension stretches until snap. And in September of 2013, we broke up over a stupid thing, you know. I was talking about, you know, her sister on DA, and she got all butthurt at one of the comments, you know, because I was making a compliment to her sister, saying that her sister was very beautiful, and, you know, she took that the wrong way, and she tried to do some context twisting to try to formulate the idea that that means she's ugly, not wanted, and hated, and I didn't know how to deal with it then. I took it as, you know, drama, and, you know, reacted in the wrong way, but, you know. But of course I made up for it, I tried to, but of course she just, you know, went off on her own path, clinging on to her ideals, and, you know, she kicked me to the curb, the proverbial curb, if you will, but, you know, it's taken me a few months, I've gotten over it, I figured out what it was, you know, it doesn't bother me anymore, it hasn't bothered me for quite some time, I just look at it, it is what it is, and I bet there's plenty of people watching right now who've had very similar experiences, you know. In life, you know, we all go through those rough relationships. This one was a long distance one, but, you know, it was as real as, you know, any physical relationship. And that's another thing I want to, you know, make clear, that just because it's electronic, you know, doesn't mean it isn't real. Now, there are the cases, yes, where, you know, you have catfishing and you have all of those other scams and scandals and other, you know, bullshit that happens on the internet. Of course it happens, you know. But, of course, yet again, scams happen in real life just as much as they do, you know, in the electronic world. Just because something happens over the internet doesn't necessarily mean you have, that anybody has the right to say that, you know, your relationship is fake, or it's not legitimate, or, you know, that's just a crock of shit in and of itself, you know. I mean, who is it for anyone to say what is legitimate and isn't legitimate, you know? But anyway, back to the point. You know, it was a ten month long relationship. It was a constructive relationship. It, you know, good memories, a lot of good things, you know. A lot of close moments we had, you know, we talked a lot on Skype and, you know, got to know each other, and we made plans to, you know, turn the digital relationship into a more real and personal relationship. But it didn't happen, and, you know, it is what it is. I'm not, you know, it doesn't bother me, it doesn't cause me pain anymore. It did for a long time, but it doesn't now. You know, I just look at it, it is what it is, you know. I can't change it, you know, and I just accept it for what it is, and I use it as a point of strength, you know, and after that whole thing, it was a point of strength, you know, it showed me qualities in myself, you know, even when the relationship was going on, you know, it opened my eyes to qualities that I had never known I had, you know, it made me realize other perspectives and other sides of me that I had never seen before, and you know, it was a building experience. I don't know how much of a building experience it was for her, you know. She might have so much mental malware, she might have not even realized the opportunity that was in front of her. She might have just collapsed inside and might still be in a proverbial drift right now, drifting through, you know, this endless loop of suffering and misery. And, you know, It was a building experience, you know. I learned a lot of things about myself, you know. I learned that I had been asleep a lot of my life, you know, that anything is possible, but nothing is, you know, nothing is written in stone, you know. It's not like, you know, oh, you're never going to, you know. But anyway, you know, it just is what it is, and, you know, I work my way through it, and, you know. But anyway, I'm going to step off of my soapbox, and I don't know if Dave is still there, but, you know.
I'm still here. It's just easier to share the link to this Hangout on Facebook, doing it on this computer over here, instead of using, you can see this here, this little micro keyboard and mouse combination, because I'm using my multimedia TV with the 42-inch screen here to host the Hangout, and obviously for, you know, just sharing the link around and stuff and typing and getting things in as quick of a way as possible. This is not the best way because this actually reduces one's speed of being able to do anything, whereas sitting down at, you know, a regular PC allows me to do that at a much, you know, faster rate. So I was just kind of putting the word out for, you know, anybody who wants to watch this and whatever. And it looks like we do have some viewers. Welcome, whoever you are.
Yes, welcome.
And I'm just going to get a fence right quick. And then sit my ass back down in front of the camera here. But I was listening to everything you said, and I agree. And that's another thing we take for granted too, is people online. It's like online can bring people together, of course, and allow us to cooperate and do all sorts of amazing things that wouldn't have been possible otherwise. But on the same token, people can also dehumanize others. Like, oh, it's just online, so it doesn't matter if I take them for granted or treat them like dirt or, you know, so on and so forth. Because it's just online, you know, acting as if, like, they're not even human. And, you know, there's a lot of really good friends you can make online. And, you know, most people think, you know, especially because the world is as big as it is, they think, oh, well, why bother with online friends? Because what are the chances we could ever hang out in person anyway? The answer to that question is way better than you think. I have met so many people from online that, you know, I never thought I would meet in person, but there it is, and I did. Like, my best friend, Katarina, she visits me. She travels the world. She's been to, like, all sorts of different states in the United States. She's been to Canada. She's been to France. She was in Hawaii. She was in Costa Rica not too long ago and kind of touring Central America. Her hotel room, when she was in this one spot in Central America, wherever the Mayan ruins are, she had a hotel room where she could actually see the Mayan ruins out her window. And, you know, she was just doing, like, this whole, you know, cool thing. And then she went, right now she's in Pennsylvania seeing her husband's family. And then she's going to be going back to Portland, Oregon to see her family. And then her and her husband are going to be going to Austin, Texas to do some sort of business stuff there. I don't really know all the details about it or anything. She's been quite the busy bee, but we've talked a little bit here and there. And on her way back through, her and Paul are going to have like a two-hour stopover in Chicago on the 11th. So I'm going to be able to see her then. And then she absolutely plans to spend a few weeks here again, you know, back in Chicago, either later this year or some point in 2015. Not exactly sure. She's just had a lot going on, but you know, when things settle down a bit for her schedule, then she's gonna pop on back over here and chill. And I'm sure we'll have plenty of new interesting PSEC videos again with her and I in person, just as, you know, we've had a bunch of those, you know, in 2013, and I'm sure we'll have them again in 2015, so that's more people can look forward to. So yeah, you'd be incredibly surprised who you can end up knowing in person, because sooner rather than later, they're either going to synchronistically somehow end up in your city, or something's going to come up to where you end up in theirs. And, you know, I know there's people thinking, oh, there's no chance of that, you know, who'd want to, blah, blah, you know, insert all sorts of excuses to try to talk yourself into why that could never happen. But that sort of shit happens all the time. I mean, if you look online on YouTube, and, you know, there's a lot of other people other than just Katarina who are always talking about, you know, going to different cities and stuff, or people they know online coming to visit them. And even if it's not, like, you know, coming necessarily to visit you personally, that can kind of end up as a side thing if you or them are going to some sort of mutual, like, event or convention or concert or vacation spot or, you know, whatever the hell it ends up being. It's one of those moments like, oh my God, you're going to be there too? We totally have to hang out. And then it aligns like that. So that sort of shit happens all the time to people who allow for that sort of thing. But of course, if you don't allow it, you're thinking, oh, woe is me. I shouldn't even bother to make any friends online because I'm never going to be able to hang out with them anyway. And, you know, you're just sitting in your room all depressed and thinking how nothing ever happens to you. But it's like, if you sit there all depressed thinking, I never get to go to the store, and the store's a block away, you know, and if you just sit there thinking that you're never going to the store, then you're not actually getting up and going. So if you're sitting there just thinking, well, that could never happen to me, blah, 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 then you're not actively putting yourself in a position to where it could. You know, if you want it to rain, don't stand in the middle of the desert. Go somewhere where it actually rains, metaphorically speaking. But a lot of people are just trapped in their paradigms, and, you know, I know exactly how that is. There's a lot of things that I didn't used to be able to do that I could do now, and I realized that the only reason that I didn't figure out how to do it sooner is because I was spending a lot of time throwing myself a pity party. And there's a lot of things that I can't currently do now, but I realized that, okay, there's either blocks in the way, or I'm currently in progress forward to eventually getting to that. Because people also have a problem with wanting instant gratification. They're thinking that they have to already be at their destination before they can even begin their journey to that destination. Or a simpler way to say it might be, they expect to plant a tree seed today and have a 40-foot tree tomorrow. And when that doesn't happen, they're like, I'll never be able to grow trees. I'm too stupid. Whatever. You know, we want that instant gratification because we're taught that our pace isn't good enough. We're told we're going too fast or too slow or not doing this the right way or not doing that the right way. So we're constantly having it drilled in our head that nothing we could ever do our way could possibly be right. We have that constantly drilled in our head. So how can we respect our own pace if we're constantly getting brainwashed with the idea of nothing we could ever do, no matter what, is ever right? Our way isn't right. So if we're ever going to succeed, we have to do it somebody else's way. And then we put people on pedestals. Then you have all those well-intended self-help gurus and things like that. That, you know, a lot of them are very well-intended. But the problem is that even though that self-help guru might very well be saying, this is the way I did it, that's just proof that it can be done, but you got to find your own way at your own pace. People kind of ignore that second part in one ear and out the other. And so they try to do things exactly as that particular self-help guru did it. And inevitably, for most people, that fails hardcore. And then they're like, well, everybody else can follow that and do it and succeed, but I can't. So I must be stupid and incapable, and there's something wrong with me. Or that was just a scam. They were lying. They're a jerk face lying to me. How dare they? So either the person's, you know, projecting inward and bashing themselves, or they're psychologically projecting outward and going to that other person like, I tried your bullshit and it didn't work. Fuck you, you scammer. So it's, and they totally missed the point of the fact that they said, hey, I'm just giving what I did as an example that it's possible, having, you know, evidence to back it up, and then saying, you have to find your own way to do it. And then they explain how to find your own way. But it's that whole finding your own way part that most people just ignore in one ear and out the other. Because they've been taught that their own way isn't good enough. So they have to try to mimic, to parrot somebody else's way. That's also why a lot of these wannabe scientists, people that slap the label of scientist on themselves and pretend they like science when they will only look at the information that already matches their current paradigm, and they'll just ignore, you know, anything else because it's like, oh, that seems weird or unrealistic to me or whatever, so I'm just going to pretend that's not there. So they stay locked within their paradigms because they're on this ego trip that they have to be right. But the funny thing is the way they do that is they have certain archetypes that they're following. Oh, that guy with a PhD over there did it exactly this way and thinks exactly like this. So their view is the right view, and they are absolutely right because they have all this money and they have a PhD and they're friends with Stephen Hawking or whatever the fuck the situation is. So then it's like it just gets into like a massive intellectualism clusterfuck with some of these psychological projections. And that's one of the many outward ones that people do. Because they're locked in these paradigms, and, you know, especially, again, the male egotism, and we're taught to be all macho. We're taught we have to know anything. We're taught we have to know everything in advance of even being able to learn it. And if we don't just know, and if we're not immediately right, then we're stupid and we're weak. We're taught that, you know, making mistakes is not a valid learning process. Even Einstein said, anyone who's never made a mistake has never tried anything new. Mistakes are part of the learning process. But guys are taught that if you make a mistake, you're weak. You can't make a mistake. You have to succeed, bam, right off the bat. And if you make any mistakes or have to do it on, you know, take too many tries to do it, then you're just weak. You're just a loser. You know, picture the classic kids movie where the kid that, you know, the little kid that hasn't really learned how to play baseball very well is up to bat and constantly missing the ball, and all of his teammates are like, we're going to lose because of you. You loser, it's your fault. You're bad at playing, so it's your fault we're losing. You're a stupid loser. You know, so it's like guys have that, you know, ingrained into them that they have to know everything and do everything, like, right away. And if they can't, then they're a loser. They don't want to be a loser. So they're, like, really all defensive. So they will take these paradigms of information, and they'll just be all bold. And no matter how full of shit they are, they'll be like, no, motherfucker, I'm right about this. And it's like, instead of actually proving why they're right, they think that if they yell enough names at you loudly enough, that is evidence to their correctness. I see it in message forums all the time. Somebody says, well, blah, 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 this and that. You know, they're saying something that's totally not even making sense to physics. And somebody who actually knows the material politely comes up and says, well, what about this, this, and this? And the immediate reaction is, well, I'm not even going to talk to you. You're a stupid loser. And you must think you're not intelligent. And I agree. You know, and then they'll like block you, or they'll just like keep saying, I'm not even going to read what you're going to say because I already know that it's all crap because I'm intelligent. You're stupid. You know what you're talking about. I do. And it's just like this whole egoic clusterfuck. They feel that if they're not right about every little thing, that their reality is going to collapse and explode and they're going to cease to exist or something. And you not only see that in like online message forums and in grade school and in high school and in the workplace, you also see it in scientific communities and everything else like that. People assume that science is always right, and that if scientists are up there saying something, that it must be right, and they act as if science is this perfect way of getting to the absolute truth of things, because science is supposed to be the exploration of knowledge to simply discover what is and what isn't for whatever it is or isn't. And people don't realize that most of these scientists are just like these big grown-ass babies who have preconceptions of reality, and they try to look for evidence that what they believe is right. And anything that might contradict that, they're like, oh, you're a fringe nutcase. And that so-called fringe nutcase might say, well, look, I've done all these experiments. I've documented all the evidence. You can review it yourself. And you would think that a fellow scientist would just say, oh, well, gee, he has evidence. It's documented. He's experimented. I better look at his evidence and double check it and make sure he did the experiment right, and maybe even do the same experiment myself so I can see whether or not it's right. And if it's not right, then I could tell him what he did wrong. See, that would be civil. That's not how scientists are. Instead of doing that, they're like, I'm not going to bother looking at your pseudoscience. That's not evidence. That's an insult to my intelligence. Go away, little boy, you fringe nuts. I'm not even going to look at your worthless contrivances, because you're obviously delusional and have been watching too much sci-fi TV or listening to this other guy that I equally don't like, and I'm going to compare you to him now as a form of insulting you. And you're just so beneath me. Get away. And that's how science really is. And it's also that way because scientific data has become industry. If you have a current belief system that one particular science works a certain way, and that's become an industry, that shit's making profit and has shareholders and everything else. And if new data comes along and says, well, actually, I've got a better way of doing this over here, then that takes this industry here and blows it up, which means no more profits over here. Now, of course, someone civil and reasonable would think, well, that's no big deal if this proves this wrong, because everybody over here can just switch over to this and nobody loses any profit. But they don't think that way. They totally do not think that way. Anything to add?
No. Nothing of major note.
Are you sure?
Yeah, more or less. I can't think of anything at the moment.
Should we get into our surprise that we mentioned earlier?
Yeah.
Might that be a good time, you know, because the little surprise that we mentioned earlier kind of matches in with what I was saying about, you know, science.
In a moment, I shall be back.
Okay. Because this has to do with something that was, happening in the NASA headquarters group on DeviantArt. And that is the DeviantArt group that Rich runs. And basically, I'm going to start off just the basic punchline story, and then I will let Rich continue with the details when he gets back, seeing as, you know, it's his group and all. But basically this. There was this person by the name of William Black, although I doubt that's actually his real name, you know. And we also jokingly refer to him as Black Caulk, C-A-U-L-K, as in, like, adhesive sealants, but, you know, the innuendo and play on words is kind of obvious with that. And that metaphor is obviously representing ego. Because this guy is one of those people that I'd say he likes to debate, but he really actually doesn't. He just kind of likes to throw his weight around at everybody with the pseudo-intellectualism and just talk down to everybody. And he just, I mean, we all know the type. We all know that sort of personality type. Well, I was reading on that group, and I just found it just kind of funny. And I was thinking, you know, this guy's obviously a troll. And nothing pisses trolls off more than when you're polite and respectful to them. So what I decided to do is I gave him the link to the summary version of Larkin Rose's little diatribe, if you want to call it that, called Removing Mental Malware. And it's really great. And Larkin Rose is very civil in that, very logical, very straightforward, makes a lot of good points. And what he goes into is basically about a lot of the type of stuff that we just explained, that people are looking to cling to belief systems and not really explore reality. So they will often exclude information, you know, in their research and only, you know, go to the information that already fits their paradigm. So he was talking about scientists that do this, people that slap the label scientist on themselves, but they'll only look at what they already believe within their paradigm, and doing that is not science at all. And, you know, people who blindly believe the mainstream news headlines and calls everybody else a delusional idiot. And on the other side of the coin, you've got the truthers that they believe what they believe, and they equally are not willing to look outside of their predetermined box. And when anybody says, hey, look over here, they're like, oh, you're just a sleeping sheep. You shut up, you sheep. You know, when really, that's just a defense mechanism for like, oh, you're giving me new information that conflicts with what I have, and I don't want to look at that. So it's like two sides of one coin. And Larkin Rose really outlines that perfectly. So all I did is I replied to Mr. Black's little I'm holier than thou rant that he was on. And I just said, hey, here is a link that, you know, y'all might be interested in checking out. So I gave him the YouTube link, and that was it. And dude just blocks me right after, you know, making a comment like, we can, like, read it verbatim in a moment here, but it was something like, oh, well, you know, you seem to think you're unintelligent, and I agree with you, and something stupid like that. And then he blocks me, and I was laughing, and I thought it was so funny. And all I did was post, a screenshot of that and the fact that he blocked me. And then he did a DMCA takedown on that screenshot, claiming that I violated his copyright or whatever, infringement, blah, 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 which is totally stupid. And then, because he didn't like what I did, not only did he make that false claim about me, which, who cares, he's just throwing a tantrum, he starts claiming that NASA headquarters is infringing on my artwork and trying to ruin me and blah, all this, like, nonsense, and we're like, what? So wait a minute. Now I'm personally responsible for, like, representing an entire group that's, like, not even my group? I mean, yeah, I'm an admin on there, but like me and 20 other people, you know, it's like, it was just totally ridiculous. And in a journal that I made called The Dichotomy of Overthinking, and, you know, that's in my DeviantArt journals, and I'll be sure to leave the link to that in the description section of this video. But, you know, besides going into that dichotomy in the last portion of the journal, I mention that particular situation just as an example. And, you know, of course, I link to all the relevant conversational links, message threads, so on and so forth. The journal that Mr. Big Black Hawk, Hawk Sealands, you know, posted about all of this, so on and so forth. And he was, like, steaming for, like, a week or something.
Oh, yeah, he came back 5 days later, and he was like, you guys are so full of shit. I hate you. Fuck
and
you.
And he starts spamming the main page of the group with all of this slanderous bullshit that it's, like, it's way too funny to even get angry about.
And then only not even 48 hours later, he hides all of the comments, minus the ones that we hid because it was spam.
Yeah,
he hides all the rest of them because he knows he's wrong.
He was getting
and then he proceeds to go into some of those journals and hide some of the comments he doesn't approve of, that he doesn't want to go on to say that he said. Everything that we called his crock of shit on for, he would context twist, turn around, and William Black is his name. If you want to look him up on DA, I suggest he would probably love the page views. I suggest faving his work because it's good work. I like it. I think it's cool. I blocked him. I don't care. But he's an artist.
He is a very creative artist, but I wish he would use that creativity with speaking to other human beings instead of talking with his big black sealant mechanism. But anyway, what I was saying is he was trying to make us angry. And we were laughing harder and harder. Like, I guess he was really, really hoping that he would just get us, like, all enraged. And I guess it's not within his paradigm to, you know, think that he could go hardcore on somebody like that and actually not piss them off, and that their only reaction would be, like, laughing so hysterically that they're practically rolling out of their chairs, you know? So he kept trying to push and push and push, and we just kept laughing at him. It got to the point where we invited him to be on this very hangout. He declined in his silence, of course. He wouldn't even acknowledge that we invited him. And that's about when he started, you know, hiding all of his comments. And I'm like, well, let's not hang out to where we can...
I should not be invited. I am William Black. I am the greatest king in all of the universe. I am one of the great noble elites. I am son of King George VI. I do not feel the need to go on Google Hangout with these simpletons. I went to Cambridge and Harvard. I am a brilliant intellectual engineer. Look at me. I am so brilliant. Oh no, General Tate tripped me, that bastard. He kicked me off my horse. Oh dear. I got mud all over my little medals. Oh, now my uniform is all dirty. Our NASA headquarters screwed me over.
You didn't fall. You pooped your foot out. That's why it's dirty.
I have one question for you. The 44 Magnum is the most powerful handgun in the world. Do you feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
Look,
and I mean that proverbially, of course. I'm not threatening you. I'm just joking.
Because then he'll be like, oh my god, you infringed upon my Second Amendment rights. I'm going to DMCA your face. Or something ridiculous like that.
I infringed on your Second Amendment rights by using what?
my hand that's pointed like a gun that, like, or something, but it can't act like somebody. But, you know.
The only thing I infringed on was the derp gun. Derp.
Derp.
I can count to potato.
But I was telling him that, hey, you can come on and we'll talk face to face, voice to voice, no hiding behind text. And he's like, no, oh, shit. They're serious.
He probably thought we were bluffing, too. Well, Mr. Black, we're not bluffing. We were never bluffing. See my smile? See how happy I am? I don't care. I'm glad you're you. I'm glad I'm me. Why don't we be friends? Why don't you unblock me? Why don't you talk to me? Why don't you make another account, tell me that you unblocked me because you... Let's just agree to disagree. Let's like each other's work. Let's be civil. Let's be nice. You can be part of my group. You can post your work. I'm just making a point from my point of view. No assault on you. All that I ask is that you be more civil, but you decide not to be. You decide to be a butthurt little bitch because you got told. You got told you was wrong. You got told you was wrong. You got told you was wrong. And you've been chasing your tail the whole time, acting as if though it's us. Oh, I'm going to get them yet. I'm going to get them yet. Those bastards, I'm going to get them yet. And really, I think now you're
ready. Okay. Next time, Gadget. Next time.
For anybody who's ever met your Gadget. Go, go, Gadget. Dildo. I said dildo, not vibrator. Anyway.
Wow, man. Wow. If you can envision the Picard facepalm, that, you know. But anyway, yeah, Black, now Black is an entertaining individual, entertaining human being. He tried to destroy my group. He tried to ruin my character. He tried to defile me in Paradigm, or Dave Kelso, as he will now know him from now on.
All he did was make everybody laugh hysterically.
All he did was make us laugh, and all he did was literally urinate all over himself. He tried to urinate on us, and he just couldn't aim quite right, and it just went up in the air, and it's like a walk in the park, you know?
All he did was get you, like, 30 more members due to the entertainment factor, and people kept going to both you and me privately, laughing their asses off, and going like, dude, what's up with the new comic relief you guys got going on in the group? And we're just laughing like, he's just all, you know, butthurt because he can't agree to disagree. And they were just laughing and telling us what a pathetic loser he is and just laughing with us. And they're like, he actually thinks you're mad? He doesn't realize all this is funny? We're just like, no, man. He actually seems to think that he's pissing us off or something. And they're like, dude, be obvious.
I am William Black. I am talking to Harvard Space Engineer colleagues on G+, and I will not provide links because I don't want you to see our conversation, because I'm afraid. Kissinger will rape me.
Not to mention, disagreeing with him makes you mentally imbalanced. Anybody who agrees with
that? Neurological disorder, because if you do not agree with me and my holiness, you are mentally imbalanced, because only a mentally balanced individual would agree with me, and only a mentally unbalanced individual would disagree with me, because I am King Poopy Pants and I have cork on my tip.
So, do you actually want to read some of this garbage verbatim?
Okay, let's dig into the
audience here, because I know you've got the link to my journal up with the other reference links, and I think there's a couple of things he posted on your group's main page that he didn't actually hide.
Yeah, there's also some stuff. I'll go into the history here of what occurred. So that way people have some context. So let's stop with the curve.
I'll mute out and let you go into, like, narrator mode here. Oh, my remote control is over here.
Okay, anyway. This was a long, long debacle. Where to start? Okay, to go to the NASA headquarters main page. Maybe while I'm at it. Let's see. Okay, now, I don't know how good the quality of this is, but try to make out some of it as discernible as possible.
I did kind of, break down the storyline in that journal entry.
I know. But I want people to at least have some semblance of where to navigate. This is NASA headquarters. It's my pride and joy, big group. You know, 395 members, 490, well, actually, no, it's not accurate. 416, if you count all the admins, 493 watchers. It's a good-sized group. It's a hub for where you can share aerospace, aviation, sci-fi, you know. Oh, where is it? Let's go clear back to the beginning. So, let's see. This would have started... Man, I can't believe it was this long ago, but back in September 16th.
Just do me a favor and don't actually show a shot of his page or any of his images or whatever. Let people, go directly to the link if they want to see it, but don't show his crap. We don't want him crying, so please don't show it.
I'm just going to show it anyway to piss him off. Okay. Okay, here we are. NASA awards contracts to Boeing and SpaceX. If we just go down here, I give my perspective on, how all of the contracts are basically rigged, I mean, the only way anything gets done in Washington, D.C. is via bribery. I mean,
Hey, Rich. Boeing. I mean, seriously, don't show it because
I know. No.
I know. So,
don't show anything
of his.
I'll only show that little black box.
Because YouTube can get kind of censorship Nazi sometimes, so, let's not take it there.
No, I ain't going to show his page. That's joking.
Don't show his...
I'm showing the comments here. The comments. As you can see on the screen, depending on how well the screen quality is. Okay. I basically stated that...
We can't see the screen anymore, at least. Oh, now I can. Weird. It's like your screen went out, then it went on. That was weird. Okay, go ahead.
It's probably because I'm scrolling. But anyway, basically what I said, it basically started out, with... Well, unfortunately, that's what happens when you have a world elite who are hell-bent on preventing man from doing what he was meant to do, explore. And I was basically stating that, the competition between SpaceX, Sierra Nevada Corporation, and Boeing is all just kind of a big cock-wagging contest in terms of who gets the funding. I mean, it's safe to say with SpaceX, if you're in a space-related thing, that... It's 100% American-made, but as with Boeing and, all of that stuff, it's relying on Russian-made rocket engines, which really doesn't take the dependence off of Russia, which is what they were hoping, which is what they're saying it will do, which it won't. That's kind of an oxymoron, even though I don't have a problem with us using Russian-made stuff, because the only reason we're enemies with Russia right now is because... The New World Order is playing the manipulation game and pinning both sides against the middle, and Putin realizes it, but unfortunately, a majority of the American public doesn't, and William Black is, safe to say, one of those people who just does not understand that the only way to get anything done in the world is through bribery. And he basically just... goes on to see, I don't see any reason for your views, your views are dumb, there's no such thing as bribery, And I basically go on, he basically presents a bunch of history that I'm already aware of, tries to throw it in my face that I'm stupid, don't know what I'm talking about, et cetera, so on and so forth, presents the government reported Kool-Aid, all of that stuff. And I basically go on into my spiel of how I feel about it, and then he retorts back that I'm just a big dummy, doesn't know anything, in a really long way, long, proficient manner, of course. You know, and he tries to use the definition of what aristocracy means, and I know what aristocracy means, and, you know, he's trying to act as if I know literally next to nothing. You know, and that's kind of how it all got started, and I respect his rights to view. I never censored. I never said that he was dumb. I never retorted saying that he's an asshole who just needs to go drop off the face of the earth. I never once said anything like that, and I won't, because none of it would be true if I did. He has his views. I have mine, and I just let it lay at that, you know. In my group, I feel everybody should have the right to, you know, share their viewpoints if they feel that they need to be shared. But, you know, it's different, on the other hand, when you have some guy who thinks so highly of his own viewpoints that he thinks anybody else who thinks on the contrary or differently is, you know, dumb or not worthy of note. You know, that's kind of a Thomas Edison move. You know, it's like, oh, nothing worthy of note. Yeah. And, you know, I do follow-up stories on, you know, all of that. You know, the Sierra Nevada challenging the NASA space taxi deal. And he comments on that. I never replied because it was his viewpoint. I knew where he was standing, and if I said anything, I knew he would just do more of the same retorting. And then, only a month ago, just about a month ago now, a month ago tomorrow, by tomorrow, NASA issues stop work order on space contracts, and basically it's a news story about, you know, what happened with basically Sierra Nevada Corporation basically protested NASA's decision, and NASA stopped it for a few days. And currently they're being processed through the Government Accountability Office, which is probably just a big giant word for saying, you know, fuck off, we don't care, you know. And anyway, and I did the updates on that, you know, that it went ahead anyway because NASA said that they had statutory authority and all that stuff, you know, typical bureaucratic beat around the bush. And, you know, I gave my perspective again, you know, with the 100% U.S.-made stuff, campaign funds, etc., Elon Musk, you know. And he goes into the whole, you know, because I had a feeling he would comment again. I knew he would go there. I knew he would say something because he had said it on the last two journalists dealing with that, you know, giving his view, like somehow my view of it skewed or not right or not correct, you know. And then Paradigm fires the shot heard around the world. This is an unrelated side topic, but felt compelled to share. And the comment he replies with, you have convinced me that you, in quotation marks, do not believe that you can know anything. I am inclined to agree. Underlined you, cannot. And then we post the screenshot, and I reply, it is better to have people wonder if you are a fool than to open your mouth and prove all those in question correct, because I called him on his crap shit that he's a know-it-all, you know, acting like a know-it-all piece of crap, you know. And I, you know, further to say I admired his quest for knowledge, and I just said, you know, it's better to look at the whole picture when dealing with topics than to claim bits and pieces of information that only back up your view, you know, your paradigm. And, you know, it kind of just went on from there, and, you know, later on, you know, and now a lot of the comments have been hidden because he knows he's wrong, because he knows what he said is wrong, because if he were so confident on his views, he wouldn't feel a reason to need to hide his comments. And basically, he went into a, you know, belittle moment. And then he tries to retort, you know, to me, you know, saying, I've not said you're stupid, I've merely cited specific facts, and yet again underlined specific, only specific meaning things that back up my viewpoint, you know. And he accuses us of making shit up, you know, government conspiracy, etc., you know, blah, 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 you know. And acts if, yet again as if he's correct on everything and we're just dumb and don't know anything, blah, 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 blah. Essentially, it's just a bunch of rhetorical, you know, BS that just continues to go on, and it just gets more and more entertaining to the point where he is spamming our page with just nonstop, you're stupid, you suck, you're gay, I hate you. Really, when it comes right down to it, I've said my piece on it so much anymore that I just don't really feel the necessity or the need to go into full details on it. Just kind of give an overall, just kind of bland specific as to what occurred. You know, I really don't, it's not something that I just feel I have to really go into detail with. If anybody wants to look at it for themselves, they can. The group is a completely public open page, you know.
Yeah. I'll make sure to post the necessary links in the description here. Your mic cut out again. Your mic is still acting up. Like I could barely hear you. I can barely hear you. Like you're audible, but barely. Like your mic is like totally like foobar in here. Yeah, that happens with this microphone from time to time. So bear with us. It'll resolve itself momentarily. It doesn't usually last for too long. Because Mike will, like, crap out, and then it'll work again. So he's exited, and then he'll rejoin, and hopefully that'll correct his microphone dysfunction there. Bear with us for just one moment. The next thing I was going to do was just, play the short little, you know, Lark and Rose thing, the mental malware thing, not like visually showing the video, but just the audio of it. But of course, I want to wait until Rich's microphone is actually functional again to do that. And so far, still no go. But this happens sometimes on Skype and on Google Hangout and stuff. It doesn't usually last for very long. He usually kind of texts that. So just bear with us for just one moment. I heard something. I just heard a tap, tap, and it was clear. It wasn't like really like under. I heard another tap there. You're really low. You're coming in super duper low, like way low volume. Like you can be heard, but barely.
Yeah, I'm gonna fix it.
There
just
we are.
A second.
Got it. Perfect. Got it. You're
Is that
back.
Work? Okay, it's working.
Welcome back. Yes. Welcome back.
Good. Finally.
Cool. Yes. Thanks. Yeah, it wouldn't take long. So, would it be okay if I played the audio version of the mental malware Lark and Rose thing so that our viewers can see that my link was in no way derogatory, no way insulting. You know, Lark and Rose wasn't up there like, you're all a bunch of pussies if you don't believe me or anything like that. He wasn't being a dick. He was very professional and logical about it. So I was thinking I want to play the audio of that into here. So for those of you who might not feel like, going and looking up that manually, that you could just, you know, get it in this one and not have to, you know, go elsewhere for it. What do you think, Rich?
Anyway, I just want to make it really clear as I was going to, you know, NASA headquarters is completely public, open page. It's completely viewable to the World Wide Web. You can come on and look at what I'm talking about. The comments are on the main page. You just have to do some clicking around. Doesn't take all that much to see what William Black said, what I said, what Paradigm said, and, you know, whatever perspective you walk away from is completely valid. I don't care.
Believe nothing.
The only point we are trying to make here is that William Black is a know-it-all. And it's going to get him nowhere in life, because you cannot be a know-it-all. It just doesn't happen.
Nothing, disbelieve nothing, question everything. So, the only reason that, you know, we're even bringing any of this up is because this is Paradigm Shift, an educational comedy. And the best examples for paradigm shifting are real-life things that actually happen, interactions between people, real situations. There's so many of these, you know, so-called paradigm shifters, self-help gurus, whatever else, that are giving a lot of lip service about metaphorically and conceptually and intellectually and whatever, and they're making good points, but they don't actually have anything to, like, back themselves up. You know, they're not saying, well, yes, I've applied this in my life, and here's evidence of that, and so on and so forth. They're just up talking about what, you know, they might have read in some college textbook or something, and they're like, oh, well, I know this, so I'm on my cloud, and you will bow to me, and they're all lip service. You know, I'm not out there trying to do that sort of thing. I like to cite actual examples and show people how things are, you know, actual practical application and what ends up end resulting, so that, you know, people can see various concepts, you know, in play instead of just lip service about a concept or an idea but nothing further. So this is just one of those examples, again, about, you know, state of being. Be authentic with yourself, keep to your preferred state of being, and then the mind is clear, and you can make rational choices instead of getting all and then, you know, doing what you've always done and getting what you've always gotten. Because a lot of people think that, oh, well, if you're nice to a bully, that doesn't work. That just shows the bully that you're weak and the bully's going to win. No, depends on how you do it. If you're using that as a tactic, then yeah, the bully's probably going to win. But if that's actually your genuine state of being, then there really is no contest. The bully only thinks they're in a fight, but they're really kind of like the man from La Mancha and fighting the windmill, so to speak. That's, you know, really, really where that's going. So, anything else you want to say before I play this through, or what?
Nothing currently, no.
Well, beyond that, as I start playing it, I just want to make sure that, like, I got the volume, the volume of this right. One second here. I accidentally had the stream that we're doing here loaded in another tab from when I was sharing the link, and I didn't know it was still going. So I started to turn up the volume, and I heard myself, and like, oops, and I like turned that back down and closed that out. Okay, let's give this a shot. Removing Mental Malware by Larkin Rose.
The title of my talk today is Removing Mental Malware.
How does that sound? Is that clear?
Sounds good.
Okay, just wanted to make sure, you know, whether I need to go up or down or if this is fine. So apparently this is fine. Hopefully everybody else agrees. Here we go.
The title of my talk today is Removing Mental Malware. Malware as in computer malware, where somebody writes a program and sticks it on your computer by way of a virus or something. It'll be the mental version of that. Step one is, do you want to know the truth? If you really want to know the truth, that requires you to put everything you believe at risk, to question everything you assume, to question everything you think you've already figured out. We believe what we're taught. We believe what we hear everyone around us telling us, what our teachers tell us, what our parents tell us, what the community around us tells us. You may have some pet theory, some conspiracy theory, or some weird theory that other people think are weird. And if you found out the truth, you might find you were actually wrong, that your theory was bogus. And if you are not open to that possibility, then you're not really going for the truth. On the other hand, there may be somebody who says, well, I believe what the mainstream believes, and I believe what everyone around me believes, and I'm not going to consider anything that sounds unusual or weird. They don't want to know the truth either. Wanting to know the truth requires risking what you already have and what you're already comfortable with, which is why most people don't want to know the truth. Assuming you actually want to know the truth, how do you get there? By using the scientific method or the scientific process. I'm a huge fan of the scientific process. I think it's the only way to reach rational conclusions. However, I'm also a huge critic of a lot of people who stick the label scientist on themselves. The scientific process, in a nutshell, is you take in evidence, you take in data, and from it you try to extrapolate an explanation of reality, or pieces of reality. You try to get a worldview that actually matches the world outside of you. And sometimes you find out, whoops, well, that data made it look like this, but now this data makes it. And so you have to test your theories and sometimes throw them out. A lot of people who wear the label scientists and pretend they like science, what they do is take in a lot of evidence, look at the stuff that already fits what they already believe, and the other stuff, that's just weird. We're going to pretend that didn't happen. So by the scientific process, I don't mean come to the results that are now usually labeled under science. I mean the actual scientific process of look at the world, take in all the evidence you can, and then try to figure out reality from that, even if the evidence is weird, disturbing, and goes against what you already want. Another problem that stops people from using the scientific process is when it starts to point at a conclusion that they don't like. They will often bail out. If you start to see a rational examination of the evidence pointing towards you were totally wrong about something, most people will bail out and run the other way because they're invested in what they already believe in. Now, this is especially true if it's something that you believed in your whole life, you've worked on, maybe you've devoted your career to something, and somebody comes along and says, I want you to consider this and rationally look at the evidence and find out that your entire career was based on a gigantic lie. There is a huge motivation to not look at that, to not use the scientific process. That's what each one of us has to look out for inside our own heads. Are there any walls we put up because we think, I don't really like where that evidence and logic is leading me, I'm just going to kind of skip a wall over there and pretend I didn't see that? That's the comfortable, easy thing. There are lots of conclusions people don't want to reach. There are lots and lots of conspiracy theories, and when people say conspiracy theory, they're usually bashing it, and what they usually mean is, I don't want to consider the possibility that the explanation for this event that happened is something that's really going to creep me out. So I'm going to call it a conspiracy theory. That is not scientific, and that is not rational. When you have things happen like what happened in Boston and 9/11, I don't even bother telling people what I think very often or arguing the evidence. I just go to people and say, did you look at this evidence? Did you approach this wanting to know what happened? Or did you approach this determined that this will be the conclusion you reach no matter what? And that's most people, because most people don't want to know the truth. And the only people who ever move it forward are the ones who say, yeah, I want to know the whole truth. It might be unpleasant, and it might totally mess up my view of the world, and might mess up my life and everything else, but yeah, truth's got to come first. Assuming we want to know the truth, and assuming we know the scientific process, why do we come to so many different conclusions? What messes things up for us? Checking for warped perceptions. The primary problem in the world is not greed, and it is not hatred, and it is not malice. Is the fact that people's perception of reality is hugely twisted by things they're taught, by things they hear all around them, their upbringing. I think it's pretty self-evident that if you have one huge group of people who means well and wants truth and justice to prevail and sees reality as it is, and another huge group of people who wants truth and justice to prevail and they see reality as it is, they probably wouldn't be trying to murder each other. Which means the underlying problem in every war is not the hatred, even though there's obvious surface animosity while they're trying to kill each other. It's warping of perceptions. At least one side, and I would say both sides every time, their perceptions have been warped such that they think trying to kill that other guy is necessary for humanity. And the guy over there that's trying to kill them is necessary for humanity. And if the one side or both sides whose perceptions were mangled could fix their own perceptions, the war stops. Because they suddenly realize, okay, you think you're the good guy, I think I'm the good guy. If we both understand reality, we'll probably stop killing each other. The problem is, this is something I refer to as mental lenses, things that are inside our head that warp the way we see the world. Everybody thinks he sees the world as it is. It's impossible not to. You think you see reality, you think you have a pretty good grip on reality. There may be things you say, well, I don't know about this and I don't know about that, but I have a general grasp on what's going on. Nobody thinks his own perception is messed up. Now, everybody can point to all sorts of other people. And pointing out that somebody else is delusional doesn't make them not delusional, even if they are. The only thing that moves humanity forward is if somebody dares to look inside their own head and say, are there things that are messing up my perception of reality and making me do stupid stuff? Because the only way you can actually change is yourself. Unfortunately, most people would much rather shoot at other people than say, maybe my belief system is based on some bogus ideas. So for the past 10,000 years or whatever, we've just been killing each other because I'd rather kill you than think about my own paradigm. Not a good situation, but it is changing with events like this. Why would our perceptions be warped? When I talk about mental malware, I mean stuff that was put there intentionally to mess you up. Most of what we believe is passed on to us from our parents, our teachers, our friends, people around us, our society as a whole, the media, all the things we're exposed to. I do not believe that everybody out there telling a lie is trying to tell a lie. I believe the vast majority are just passing on lies that they were taught because they don't know any better. When parents teach their children stupid things that they learned, they're not thinking, ha ha, I'm going to get my kids for this one. They think the same reality to the next generation. When teachers teach the same garbage that they were taught that's untrue and based on a bunch of false paradigms, they're not trying to be nasty, they're just passing on their own misunderstanding. And this is why, number one, is important. We have to want to know the truth. Because if someone who cares about you and loves you is telling you this and they sound so sure of themselves, the hardest thing in the world is to think, well, you know, maybe you're totally wrong, Mom and Dad. You know, I know you mean well. I don't think you're trying to fake me out, but I think you and everyone around me might be totally wrong about this. Another reason people don't want the truth is if you're the only one who believes something, it's really uncomfortable. I suspect people in this crowd know that a lot more than the general public. Not being in the majority is an uncomfortable place to be, which tends to push us into a majority that all can feel confident that together they believe their own destructive things. For the purpose of this talk, what matters is getting it out of your head. Those of you who know about the Prussian indoctrination system and like John Taylor Gatto's work, you can very much see the openly admitted intentional design of programming people to be easily controlled and unthinking genes. It doesn't even matter if you got these warped perceptions by way of misinformed but benevolent sources or actual psychos trying to control you. Because either way, if they're stuck in your head and messing with your perception, then they need to be fixed. The primary example of malware that I talk about is the malware revolving around concepts of government and law and politics and authority and crime and all the terminology and all the thought processes that tentacles come out from the belief in authority. It's really easy to point to some bad guy, to point to some tyrant, to point to some regime and say, that's the problem, they're scary, they're bad, let's go do something about them. The main problem isn't the bad guys. The bad guys will keep being bad guys. The main problem is the power they get from the warping of the perceptions of their victims. And if you fix the perception of their victims, the control freaks don't have any power anymore. Everybody believes in government. They believe it's real. They believe in the law. They believe in authority. And they have all these perceptions that they think are based on reality. That is a great sign that you have somebody controlling what's in here. But if you're convinced that it's law and it's government and it's authority, literally people feel profound moral guilt at doing something that doesn't hurt anybody but disobeys the group of people who claim to be government, who claim to have the right to rule. I love the term law-abiding taxpayer because it's people proudly displaying their malware for all the world to see. I am proud that I give my money to a bunch of crooks and I do whatever they tell me. Law-abiding taxpayer. That is all it needs. Lots and lots of history is good people who are taught to believe the lie of authority, either just spectating and doing nothing, or actively helping to dominate, oppress, or even kill their fellow man because authority told them to. And that's what I mean by the fact that the problem is not the psychos. There's only one reason we know the name Adolf Hitler, and it wasn't because of Adolf Hitler. It was because lots of people in Germany believed in the thing called authority. And so if the guy is in a certain position and has a certain job description, and he tells you to do something, well, you do it. You follow orders. You enforce the law. If they didn't believe that, what could one goofball with a stupid mustache possibly have done on his own? Same thing everywhere. Red China, Soviet Union, you can go anywhere you want. The mass oppression was not because all the individuals doing it thought, yeah, today I just want to go hurt somebody. It's because they were raised with the malware of authoritarianism and government and law and all these concepts that go together, so they don't really feel guilty about doing what they know is right. But Stanley Milgram did experiments which totally show that this applies to Americans as much as anybody else. We know what is right and wrong, and we will do the wrong thing if a perceived authority tells us. That's the horrendous punchline. And I highly suggest everybody go check out this. It should be required. People should be forced to read that book. Stanley Milgram's book is called Obedience to Authority, and it goes all through his experiments, which is really creepy, but it's an outstanding expose on mental malware and the destruction it leads to, making good people do really nasty, evil stuff. Even inside the freedom movement, because the malware is so lodged in most people's heads, even the vast majority of people say, I want freedom, they don't recognize their own malware. They don't even check for it. Because they think, problems in Washington, D.C., those guys are bad guys. And yeah, they are bad guys, but they're not the problem. And we have to go do something to them. And whenever that's the focus, you lose, because you miss the underlying problem of the world. The entire idea that we have to do something to the ruling class, whether we have to vote in people who will go petition us, we have to go have a protest, we have to have a revolution, there is nothing you can do to the control freaks who pretend to be government that will fix reality. As long as that malware is in their heads, it doesn't matter what you do to the current ruling class. Elections and petitions, even revolutions, they're pointless because that isn't the problem. If the problem is inside your head, shooting somebody in Washington isn't going to fix it. But if you imagine a world in which the malware is gone and tomorrow 300 million people wake up and say, I don't really feel a need to give a bunch of my money to them. In fact, I don't feel a need to use their crummy currency that keeps going down in value. I don't feel the moral obligation to obey their arbitrary, stupid commands, and I definitely don't want to fuel their war machine and their police state. So, yeah. Now, if one person does that, out come the jackboots and he gets stomped and killed and thrown in the cage. If 300 million do it, we're done. The end. As long as you're focused on doing something to the rulers, nothing fixes because they're not the problem. And all of their power comes from the malware in our heads, our perceptions that they have the right to do this, that their commands are law, that when they say, give me money, it is robbery against taxation. These ideas in the heads of the victims are the problem. But what it comes down to is when people understand the malware, it goes away. Don't be scared of chaos and anarchy. Be scared of the guy who says, put me in charge and I will fix the world. He is not your master. You are your master.
And there we go. I didn't see anything belligerent or rude or insulting or degrading or anything like that. I felt he was being completely, perfectly logical and calm and rational. What do you think?
Yeah. To me, it's just him stating his view and stating the mere truth of the situation, you know? It just is what it is, you know?
In fact, he's not pointing fingers, he's doing the opposite. He's saying pointing fingers is a part of the malware. So it, mm-hmm. the video couldn't even be used to point a finger at Mr. William Black because it's totally the opposite context.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's just, it's, you know, it's nothing, all it was to Black was just, you know, a character attack on him because, you know, he essentially got told, you know, that your opinion is your opinion, my opinion is my opinion, and, you know.
That was exactly Rose's point. When you're locked into a paradigm, you're going to view someone else's view as a character attack instead of just seeing it as, well, it's somebody else's view.
Mm-hmm.
Like he said, it's like, oh, well, I'd rather kill you than look at my own paradigms, you know? It's like, and this is kind of the scaled-down textual version of the same thing. He, you know, Mr. Black would rather launch massive butthurt assaults at us than stop and think, do they or do they not have a point? Right now, I think they don't. But let's look at this, let's explore this, and see if I'm going to resume my current conclusions or if there's new information that might be gleaned out of this. No, that would make too much sense, and it's not self-gratifying. With that, you can't raise your fist and shake it and go, ha-ha! You're trying to make me the victim! Well, I am fighting back! Take that, monster! Ha! I will be victorious! You know, you can't do that if you're calmly going, okay, I disagree, but let's look at what you're saying. Let's take it into consideration. Let's explore this a little and see if maybe you do have a few points worth considering or if I'm still going to continue to resume my current view. And whether the person continues to resume their current view or they say, well, these points made here and here, they sound like they're actually making a little bit of sense. I'll have to think on that some more. So, you know, that sort of rational discourse does not satisfy the, you know, in this case, male insecure ego that's addicted to that, I'm going to win, Stone Cold versus The Rock, rah, thing. And just to be fair, that attitude is not restricted to males either. Girls get catty with each other for the same fucking reasons. And they treat each other in the same way. And then when you have females that, you know, have that attitude and they get into quote-unquote professionalism and intellectualism, then they just treat everybody that way. Such as, oh, there's one person that comes to mind that is in your family. I don't know if I have permission to speak of that.
Well, I don't want to save that one for another...
Okay. I'll just say that there's somebody with a psychology degree who works in a super professional atmosphere, and because they wrote a thesis on disorder,
bipolar.
Yeah, they think they are God's gift to the field, and they're not realizing that the reason they wrote such an excellent and accurate thesis on bipolar is because it takes one to know one.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you always felt victimized by this person, then you shifted your own paradigm and saw that it didn't take much more than two sentences to have this individual flail around.
Not even a sentence, two words.
Yeah, because in their paradigm, you feel victimized by them, and that's the only reality, so you couldn't possibly stick up for yourself. And even though you stuck up for yourself very civilly and briefly and, you know, were very calm about it, that still defies their belief systems about reality. So they're like Luke Skywalker, no! That's not true! That's impossible! So they literally started to snap on you and everybody else that was around you, and everyone's looking at them like, damn, what's up with that person? Whoa. Like, Rich didn't even hardly say anything, and they're, like, blowing a gasket. Well, of course they're blowing a gasket, because Rich just totally defied their beliefs about reality. And their belief about reality is that Rich is this stupid little 19-year-old that I've done all my life since he's a stupid little kid, and he's stupid, stupid, and doesn't know anything about nothing. And now all of a sudden, you act in such a way that totally blows all that out of the water. And they're like, no, my reality is shattered. Ah, I'm melting. And this person that I'm speaking of is female, so thus making the point that this sort of William Culk attitude is not restricted to males.
It's just a part of the psychological human condition is all.
Yep,
nothing more or nothing less.
Part of the matrix, as some might say, figuratively speaking. And we're learning to become unplugged from the matrix. The Matrix movies were a metaphor of that idea. We're not literally plugged into machines, but the Matrix trilogy was about, you know, Larkin Rose's mental malware explanation, you know, three full movies of it. So that's essentially, you know, the metaphor. It's about the societal indoctrination and freeing ourselves from it. So anybody who hasn't seen the Matrix trilogy yet, I would highly recommend it. It's a very, very great, you know, three movies, and it's awesome. And if you look at it from the perspective of realizing that it's metaphorically representing some stuff, you'll get a lot of benefit out of it. But if you don't realize that, then it's just a cool movie with the cool special effects and lots of ninja type moves, and wow, that was cool, and that's about all someone will get out of it if they're viewing it from that extremely narrow paradigm. But if someone's mind is expanded and seeing it for the metaphor that it is, they're going to look at it and go, oh, wow, they're making some good points out of this thing. Yeah, anything else you would like to add to this?
No, nothing of real particular note right now. I'd just literally call it just a good discussion that's kind of been closed. We've said all that we've needed to really say on the subject matter when it comes to this specific topic.
And as far as anybody watching this and in regards to William Black, you know, even if you agree with us, you know, don't go walking up to William and being a cock yourself. You know, add him to your watch, and you know, fave his art, and you know, be nice to him. I'm not suggesting anybody be all mean and nasty. We weren't mean and nasty with him. We're not advocating anybody else be either. I mean, yeah, the situation's amusing, but you know, if you know, hey, whatever you want to do, but I, you know, I'm not advocating anybody, you know, come up and, you know, be all bitchy with the guy. I'm not condoning anybody to give him attitude. You know, add him to watch, fave his art, comment on it, be nice to the guy, and, you know, like Jesus said, you know, treat others as you would want to be treated, not as they might treat you.
Exactly, yeah. I would honestly enjoy if he would just, you know, lighten up, post his stuff in my group. That's what it's there for, you know. His perspective is welcome, even though I may not agree with it or like it, you know. That's fine. He's completely within his right to hold his views, as I am to hold mine. And
even when he submitted that journal going on the tirade about both of us.
Yes, I almost forgot. Yeah, the journal.
Yeah, you allowed it to be submitted to your group. You weren't like, oh my god, it's talking negative about us, I'm not going to let that in my group. You're like, okay, you approved it, because, you know, you're not going to censor him just because you disagree and whatever. You let it through, and, you know, everybody's got their right to their take on things, and, you know, whatever, it's fine.
Mm-hmm. But his ultimate goal is to turn my group into basically take all my hard work, shove it down my throat, and tell me to, you know, suck on his big black proverbial dick, and essentially what he ended up doing was doing auto fellatio because I was never at his waist to begin with, because I wasn't going to waste my time.
I think he was hoping to divide up the members of your group into factions, turning the group inward on itself and destroying it.
That's essentially, yeah, that's what he wanted to do.
And it didn't happen. It wasn't nope. It won't happen.
Nope.
And this is why. Now, if we would have gone off half-cocked, and reacted and disrespected his right to his view, then yeah, his strategy would have worked, and that's probably the type of people he's used to dealing with. I'm sure he's used to dealing with people that are stupider than he is, and that are hostile, and that, you know, he's used to these, you know, fuck you, blah, 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 sort of dramatic reactions. I'm sure he probably is used to that. That's probably the only real reality from his paradigm. So from his view, he's thinking, okay, well, all humans are like that, and therefore, if I light the match on this kerosene, then logic dictates the kerosene will burn. And he lights the match on the water that he thinks is kerosene, and nothing happens, but he still thinks it's kerosene, and he doesn't realize it's water. So he kept trying to light it, and it kept going out. He's like, ew, why isn't it working? Because not the whole rest of the world doesn't work according to the way he views reality is being. And I'm not faulting Mr. Black with that statement. We are all brought up to think that way, that our view of reality is just how reality is, and it's the only view. We're taught that there's only one view that everybody is just taught, and that view is the view, and everybody else sees reality the same. But reality is viewed in 7 billion uniquely different ways by 7 billion people, all with their own opinions, and some of them will agree with others of them more than others. You know, you'll have similarities and differences, but despite any of those, it's still 7 billion unique individuals having their unique individual take on things, regardless of who may or may not agree on what. And that's what people don't understand. They think there's one universal view that everybody views reality through, that, you know, you're taught something in school, and that's the view, and everybody views it from that, and, like, because that's literally what we're taught, and it's bullshit. Is your mic malfunctioning, or are you just not saying?
I'm here. I'm just listening.
Well, I guess that basically wraps it up then. You know, the whole topic of male insecurity and ego just appropriately shifts to human insecurity and ego. Because that's, you know, really kind of the point. That's, you know, got to realize that's what it's about. Everybody's been indoctrinated into this, and everybody has their own particular perspective of the way they view that indoctrination. And, you know, we got to realize both our similarities and our differences of uniqueness, and learn to realize that, you know, all truths are true, all views are valid, and, you know, it's only when we disrespect each other's right to hold our views and act like Nazis and be like, no, you got to see things my way or blah, blah. Or the assumption that there's only one view of reality, so if someone's saying something different, then they must be intentionally patronizing or belligerent. Like, well, they know as well as I do that this way here is the only way to view it. So if they're saying that there's another way, then they're intentionally and knowingly patronizing me, mocking me, so I must attack. And then it's like, no, they're just being an individual. They literally view things differently than you do, but it's like, you know, we're not taught to think that. So.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, he took everything we said as a personal character attack. He was just automatically like, you know, oh, well, they don't agree with me, so that must mean they're against me.
You know, when someone thinks that there's only one view of reality, then the idea of someone saying everybody should have the freedom to have whatever opinions they want to have about things, then a person who thinks that there's only one view of reality, interprets that as, oh, well, they're only talking about, like, someone has a right to like or dislike chocolate ice cream, you know. They're not bringing it up to any more expanded than that. They're not realizing that people actually have very different views of reality. So, it, you know, the idea of someone saying, well, you have the right to your opinion, it comes off as patronizing. It would be like the equivalent of if you said, hey, ma'am, the sky is blue, and they replied back to you with, no, it's not, it's green, but, you know, you have the right to your opinion. You'd probably take that as being mocking or cocky. So that's kind of the way, you know, people view differences of opinion. It comes off with, like, that level of patronizing. And the other person tries to explain, no, dude, honestly, I really actually view things this way. But it seems so unbelievable to the other person. So then the other person attacks them. So the person with the differing view, from their perspective, they feel as if this other person attacked them first. So then if they attack back, they feel that they are initiating a return fire and they didn't start the whole thing. Whereas the person on the other side of the coin feels that, you know, the person was attacking through mockery and ridicule and sarcasm. So the person feels then that they were attacked first and that they are just returning fire. So they are literally both viewing that from the perspective of a victim, because neither of them is really clued into the idea that, hey, maybe there really are actually two differing views at work here.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty frickin' interesting.
Indeed.
Well, I guess, unless you have anything else to add.
Not particularly, no. I mean, it's just, you know, it is what it is. He has his rights to his views, I have my rights to mine, and, you know.
Everybody has their rights to theirs, regardless of what the topic or who, so... Next time you feel triggered by someone else's opinion, advice to all y'all, instead of getting, you know, all how dare you, stop and think to yourself, are they attacking me, or do they really believe what they're saying? Are they really sticking their foot out in front of me, trying to push me down? Or are they really actually believing what they're saying? And then you'll see that if they really actually believe it, then you will actually be able to see how they could actually take what you said that you feel is an innocent enough statement as an attack. Then once you can relate to them on that level, yeah, you can't make them relate back. You know, you can't be like, oh, I see what's going on. Here, I'll explain it to you and have them realize simply just because you decided to realize, no. But once you have that realization, it takes two to tango, so there is no dance if you're not tangoing. If you're not being the same as them, then there is no conflict. There's just you respecting their right to have a tantrum and them tantruming, and then that's it. And that's how conflict is dissolved.
Mm-hmm.
So, thanks everybody for watching. We'll... see you next time. Hope you found this entertaining and informative and whatever else. And if you suffered through all this whole thing and feel that it was stupid and retarded and we should be shot, then, you know, we respect your opinion too. Feel that way. So you guys can also have a good night as well.
Have a great night, or morning, evening, afternoon, brunch, lunch, wherever you are in the world watching. Have a great day, great night.
A great whatever. It's a big, round, 24-hour planet.
Uh-huh.
Adios. Peace out.